Where are Nintendo's little digital games on Switch? We have a few, for sure we have a few, but I don't know if you remember, I barely do. They had a past of releasing a whole bunch of download-only titles on 3DS or WiiWare games or DSi games, but Nintendo-published games of that ilk are becoming very few and far between on Switch. But maybe that's for the best? Let's talk about it. To be honest, as I start this video, I don't even know how much I'm gonna have to say. It's something I've been noticing over the years and truly can't even compare that directly to consoles like the Wii and 3DS and DS because, as you know if you're a regular here, I'm one of the ones who has had the pleasure of getting back into gaming with the Switch, so I played those consoles super minimally. And if you didn't know that because you're not a regular, hey, why don't you consider subscribing? We talk about Nintendo and dormant franchises and game ideas and stuff like that on our videos twice a week and on our podcast on the weekend. And lately, we've been doing that live for channel supporters. It's been fun. But back on topic, to make a claim that Nintendo isn't doing something anymore, what's the baseline we're going up against? I'd say let's compare with 3DS because it's the most recent, so it's more reasonable to compare an eShop on the Switch to it than the burgeoning DS or Wii. But also, it's the comparison that gave me the idea for this video, and it's the list I pulled up, so let's take a look. On the 3DS, between the years of 2011 and 2019, Nintendo published 181 games, at least according to the list I'm using as reference, on niwanetwork.org. If you've been keeping tally and disagree, have at me in the comments. So 181 Nintendo published games, and out of those, there are 61 download-only games. I was literally about to go through and read all of them, but you don't want that. The detailed link is in the description if you want to, but to hit some highlights, there were the six 3D classics games that Scott the Woz covered in a recent video in the card above, a bunch of novelty or useful games like Photos with Mario, Photo Pikmin, Flipnote Studio 3D, and so on. But more importantly, there were legit franchises that were Nintendo's and really found their home on the download-only list of games. Pushmo, Crashmo, and Stretchmo, Box Boy, Box Box Boy, and Bye Bye Box Boy, Dylan's Rolling Western, Dylan's Rolling Western The Last Ranger, but interestingly, the third in the series was a full retail release at $40, so moving on up in the world, Dylan, but where on earth did you go? And then more stuff like Steel Diver Subwars, Pokemon Shuffle, Dr. Mario Miracle Cure, a bunch of Picross games like Pokemon, Twilight Princess, Club Nintendo Picross, and various Kirby spin-offs like Kirby Fighter Deluxe, Kirby's Blowout Blast, and Team Kirby Clash Deluxe. And that's not even to mention a whole bunch of games that I know not that much about and don't really change the core of this conversation too much, but are probably fun to look into another day. So that's the 3DS. Now let's take a look at the Switch to compare. And before we get into any technicalities, let's get the super straightforward ones out of the way. These are Nintendo IPs and digital only, so Super Kirby Clash, Box Boy and Box Girl, Kirby Fighters 2, Jump Rope Challenge, Pokemon Quest, and now let's get into some technicalities. Mario 35, until it got delisted. Fire Emblem, Shadow Dragon, and the Blade of Light, until it got delisted. Snipperclips, until it got a physical release. Does it still count on this list then? Probably not. Cadence of Hyrule, also got a physical release, so same thing. Pac-Man 99, that one counts, easy enough. Tetris 99, same, until it got a physical release. Good Job, not sure if that's a Nintendo IP now, but Nintendo published it, so it counts. Same for the Stretchers, same for Flip Wars, same for Part-Time UFO. I mean, that one is HAL Laboratories and they're a partner of Nintendo, but not actually a first-party studio, so yeah, third-party game, first-party publishing, right? Probably. So after that confusing list, where do we stand? I think at 15, but five of those got delisted or have a physical edition, so are they really still download-only games? I don't really know. Not a huge deal, but that's where we're at. The thesis thus far has been proven. So now, why the heck do I even care? Or do I? Honestly, looking back at the 3DS games, I wouldn't say in any way that the list is inherently better than the digital-only games that Nintendo's publishing on the Switch. I mean, there are more of them for sure, but quality, quantity, there's a saying there, I think. However, a big difference is that Nintendo is developing way fewer of the games than they used to, or at least fewer of them are Nintendo IPs, I guess. Truthfully, I haven't gone to look into how many of the 3DS ones were Nintendo developed, but just about all the ones I listed earlier were either Nintendo developed or used a Nintendo IP, even if they outsourced the work itself, which happens with straight up first party games, so doesn't even matter that much. But if Nintendo was spending their time actively working and focusing on these games even a little bit, what is different now? What's changed? Well, it's safe to say that on a personal level, I don't really care at all about seeing Nintendo spend their time on the things like photos with Animal Crossing. I'd rather they just work on Animal Crossing. A decent chunk of the 3DS examples are fluff to a degree, and they're fine to stay gone. But it's the things like more franchises at the scale of Pushmo or Boxboy or Dylan that really have me curious. So if we look at these games on a development side, where are their teams today? Well, Pushmo is an intelligent systems project who, on the Switch, released WarioWare Get It Together in 2021, Paper Mario The Origami King in 2020, and Fire Emblem Three Houses in 2019. Dylan's is developed by Vanpool, who is generally a helper studio of Nintendo's. They helped with the Kirby spin-offs on Switch and help with other projects, but Dylan is their project from the ground up. And Boxboy is a HAL Laboratories project, and honestly, HAL is responsible for a ton of this side project input. But the more we dig in, the more it's evident that one thing is true. HD game development is way harder and more time-consuming than it was on the 3DS and earlier. Intelligent Systems obviously has several teams, but releasing three games in 3 years not only took a lot of their resources, but Koei Tecmo did most of the grunt work for Three Houses. Vanpool may potentially be working on something of their own at this point, but as a helper studio who aided with Kirby Fighters 2 and Super Kirby Clash, Nintendo's priority with them is obviously to be the all hands to put on a deck somewhere. And HAL did release Boxboy and Boxgirl, but they also did part-time UFO, and from what we hear, they're working really hard on the next Kirby. So long story short, I think the first part of the answer to what happened to the digital game output at Nintendo is HD. I really think that they are all hands on deck on the projects they find to be most important, which is really easy when you only have one platform. But when there's a separate handheld and home console, like the 3DS and Wii U, or Wii and DS and everything else going back, it's easier for developers to have a B team kind of waiting in the wings for their next project and can make a small game in a year or less. Kind of like a bigger scale of when Jump Rope Challenge came out last year because some developers were kind of bored. But while all of these developers are building engines or getting used to Unreal Engine or whatever else, there's a learning curve that isn't allowing for as many small projects because they are, in fact, small. Well, except for like Tetris 99, but I kind of see that as a separate thing anyway. I don't know, whatever. But even if all of that puts the Nintendo developed smaller games on hold, I would still say that the externally developed Nintendo published digital games are some of the best we've ever seen. Snipperclips, Good Job, The Stretchers, Part-Time UFO, not to mention Cadence of Hyrule. These are games that, like Microsoft did with Ori and Cuphead, Nintendo found indie devs working on projects that they thought matched their own ethos and game design philosophies closely enough, while obviously not stepping on the toes of their pre-existing series. I mean, except Cadence of Hyrule, I guess. I don't know. We'll count that one sometimes, but not others. Don't worry about it. But Nintendo publishing these games seems to mean that Nintendo believes that these games can be marketed to their target audiences, and they want to be associated with that. But that brings us to what I'm realizing is probably the biggest reason that digital-only smaller scale games are fewer and further between from Nintendo themselves, and it's that they don't need to do the work to fill that void anymore. Nintendo platforms have always skewed more towards physical sales at a higher degree than other contemporary consoles, but whereas they probably felt like they had to legitimize or subsidize DSiWare or WiiWare or maybe even the 3DS eShop, they straight up don't have to on the Switch. There are weeks in a row that Nintendo isn't the number 1, 2, or 3 of the charts, not because Nintendo games aren't selling insanely well, but because an indie game is just blowing the world away. Hades, Stardew Valley, Hollow Knight, whatever else. But if it's the case, and Nintendo doesn't need to subsidize that aspect of the eShop like they used to, why would they choose to publish any games they didn't develop at all? I think the answer is what we touched on a minute ago. Nintendo will seem to publish games that they want association with or see a business reason to push in a way that they can do best if they're publishing it. Nintendo just wants bragging rights with these games and feels they should be positioned in a certain way and that they can do that best when they're publishing them. So to bring it back to the main point, where are Nintendo's little digital games on Switch? Well, I think they'll be back a bit stronger again. We'll get a Pushmo game, a Steel Diver game, a Dylan game, but it'll be longer between these games because HD development takes longer, there isn't the same need for these games as there used to be, and idle hands are just more sparse. But I think that more and more Nintendo is aligning themselves with quality games, not just through the games they publish, but the ones they promote. In some ways, if we look to the Indie World presentations as an evolution of Nintendo's stamp of approval on smaller games, the output is more than ever. There's not a lack of games like these, there just doesn't happen to be a Pushmo game. But in that trade-off, I certainly know what I'd choose. But that's what I think. What do you think? Do you think that there are fewer of these games? I mean, there are, but are you sad about it? Let me know that and more in the comments down below. And while you're down there, be sure to like the video and subscribe to Fanatics 4 for more content like this every Tuesday and Thursday, and then our podcast on Saturdays at 10 a.m. Eastern time. The videos at youtube.com/directlytoyou, and the podcast is on podcast services where you get your regular old podcasts. Well, I think that's about it for me. Let me know what you think in the comments down below. Talk to you next time. Peace and blessings.